Great job. Good morning, guys. How are you? Are you awake? All right. Some of you are at an earlier service than normal. Some of you are at a later service than normal. That tells me you got all kinds of things going on today. But great to have you here. If you are visiting New Hope for the very first time on this Father's Day, we are honored by your presence. Thank you for coming and being with us. We would love for you to take a visitor card. It's in the pew in front of you. Fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. And then next week through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you about New Hope. Always promising never to beat on your door or bother you on the phone, but through the mail just to give you information that we hope will answer most of your questions. Let me highlight a few announcements and take care of just a little bit of kind of busy work around New Hope, and then we'll get engaged in our worship today, and you're in for a treat. You are going to have, for Father's Day, a men's four-part harmony gospel quartet. All right? So that's going to be pretty cool. All right? We're going to look forward to that. Let me highlight a couple things. One, if you would like to be part of a patriotic choir, they are going to start rehearsals this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. The other rehearsal dates are posted in the bulletin. Randy Berger will be directing the choir, and it is for July the 6th, when we celebrate 4th of July on the 6th of July. All right? So our Sunday service will have a patriotic theme to it that day, and a choir is going to share in that. So if you would like to join that choir, we would love for you to join that choir and share with us some wonderful songs on July 4th as we pay tribute to the birth of our nation. Vacation Bible School is coming up a week from today. It's going to be an evening Vacation Bible School. It will start Sunday night, and it will end on Thursday night. And God bless you. Good, I hope you felt better. It's good not to hold those in, okay? Because I'm told I've killed far too many brain cells because I've held them. But anyway, if you can help with VBS, we have a lot of volunteers already, but we can always use a few more, not necessarily as teachers, but as runners, with games, with food. So this sheet that looks like this that will come around, I've got two that will go down this side, two that will go down this side. The one that looks like this, all right, is if you would like to volunteer to help during the evening, Sunday night through Thursday night, and those dates are June 22nd through the 26th, all right? The other one that looks like this, this is if you can help with some supplies for the week of Vacation Bible School. Things like Starburst candies, Tootsie Roll candies, all right? We love to send the kids juiced up when they go home, all right? Just bouncing off the wall. Large tubs of whipped cream. This is really good stuff when I'm starting the 40 days to a healthier you today, isn't it? All right, this is pretty cool. But you'll notice things on here that you might be able to help for the kids that week, all right? So when they get to the back, they can just stop there. They don't have to be handed across, all right? So we'll go right there. Okay, what's this? Does that belong on one of those? I don't know. Okay, here's my notes. All right, we're starting a new series today. Some of you know that. It's entitled 40 Days to a Healthier You after the service. If you want to go out in the pavilion, there are a couple of books there that I'll be talking about more next week, all right? If you want to get more engaged on what we're going to begin to talk about today, there's a book called The Daniel Plan. Follows along with what I'll be preaching for the next 6 weeks. There's also a cookbook that follows along with that. Like I said, you'll hear more about it next week, but we do have them. If you want to take a look at them, they're available for purchase out there, written by the pastor of Saddleback Church, Rick Warren, and two medical doctors. And Shelley and I have found it extremely helpful over the past few months as we have been following this plan and feeling better for it. I know I can't help my looks, but I feel better about it, all right? And so anyway, we're excited to start sharing with you today. Then in the middle of August, and I really want us to get on board with this. You guys remember 2.5 years ago when we started the story? Okay? And we did 32 weeks chronologically through the Bible. We all bought books called The Story. You remember that? And we read every week. You read the chapter, and then we preached on it the following Sunday. All right? And we got to see how the Bible fits together in chronological order. And many of you said, first time I'd ever done that. First time some things made sense to us because we saw how it fit, and it was a great study. Well, the brainchild behind The Story is Randy Frazee, pastor of a church in San Antonio, Texas. And he is now following that up with part two, and it's called Believe. Think, act, and be. And it's a 30-week study. The first 10 weeks are going to be about the foundational truths of the Bible. Doctrine, all right, that are absolutely essential for us to know. The second 10 weeks is about the practices of the body of Christ, the church, things like worship and prayer and study. And then the last 10 weeks are the virtues of the Christian life, the fruit of the Spirit that God wants to produce in each one of our lives. But it's built on the foundation of truth and practice. It's a beautiful, beautiful study. There's going to be a Bible that will be available as well. All right? And it will. The other one was called The Story. This one is called Believe. You've read the story. Now live the story. That's the theme. That's the thrust. And the way this Bible is set up, it's set up just like a book, chapter after chapter, all right, not the verse kind of thing like in our regular Bible. First chapter is on God. And it has all the verses from Genesis to Revelation, all right, on the subject of God. And so you can read all about God from beginning to end as it puts together. The next one will be about Jesus Christ. And then, and so each subject that is there, you will have all the verses and it will read through. It's terrific. Now here's what's kind of fun for us. Unlike the last time where it was a finished product, all right, we had all of the banners and the displays and the videos and stuff that were out and had been enhanced and improved. We don't have that privilege this time because it's not going to be released for other churches or the mass public to use until the fall of next year. We were invited by Zondervan and by Randy Frazee to be one of 30 churches all across the United States that gets to be the test churches. So we get to add to some of the creativity of what goes on. And so that's going to be kind of fun. We will want your feedback. We've already had a two-hour phone conference with Randy Frazee on one end and representatives from the other churches on the other end of the phone and brainstorm things and ideas. And so I'm kind of excited about you all getting to be part, along with the staff, on the cutting edge of what's going to impact hundreds and thousands of churches across the United States in a year. And I think it's just going to be absolutely terrific. So just like the story, this is going to be one of those. We're going to hope that for 32 weeks you do your very best to be here on Sundays. All right? I know it's tough not to miss any, but man, that's what puts the consistency in the foundation when you can see how it all fits together. And if you do have to miss one, go to the website, watch the video, so you see it all pieces together without breaks in between them. So we're excited about that. I think that is all I'm going to say about that. There are cards out on the tables in the foyer and also out on the Daniel Plan table out in the pavilion. This is for Matt and Shelley Actis. These are the pledge cards, all right, that we want you to use. So if you picked one up a couple of weeks ago, please get this one, all right? We'd just like everybody to have the same one so we're all on the same page. For all of the family from New Hope who are going to be supporting the Actises for the next 4 years, many of you did it for 4 years. You fulfilled that obligation as of this month. If you did it for 4 years, don't think, well, I'm still going to do it. I don't need to fill out a card. No, please do it because they need to know what their monthly support is going to be for the next 4 years. And how we want you here to do it is you fill out the card. Every month you will make your contribution to the Actises, to New Hope Church. You will just on the envelope or on the memo write what it indicates on here you're supposed to write in that thing, which is UWM, which stands for the Missions Agency for them, and then we send one check from New Hope to the Mission Agency. That way, we can make sure the Actises are getting their monthly support as they need it, all right? So, please fill this out between now and July 6th. We want to have them all back July 6th, because that night, we are ordaining Matt into the gospel ministry, and we will total up all of the pledge cards, and we need to raise about $7,000 a month in support. Here's what the church board at New Hope has already done, all right? We have already upped our contribution to the Actises out of our general fund mission giving. We've increased it a third from what it was the previous 4 years, all right? So we are very excited about that, and all of us are going to get to help be a part of this. Whether you can give $5 a month or $100 a month, just indicate it on here, and all of us together, we make it happen. I also want to say congratulations to Mark Addis. Mark, stand up real quick, all right? Most of you know Mark, all right? One of our board members, one of our Sunday school teachers, but also the founder of Aviation in Action. They had their first big banquet last night as a fundraiser, had the privilege of being there. I'll be excited to hear how much you raised, all right? So let us know as soon as you find that out, but well done, well done. A few prayer requests, and then we'll engage in our worship, and we'll come around. And in fact, let's get started with doing this right now. Can I have a few volunteers? Ladies, preferably. Ladies? Oh, very good, because this is Father's Day. So I want you to give us every man in the church, okay? Every man in the church gets one of these. So if we could have two more ladies, one on that end and one on that end, and you can just hand the basket down, that would be great. Men, what you're going to get to, I think the coolest gift we ever gave to men was what? You guys remember? The multi-tool, yeah, that one was so cool. And then the next favorite one probably was the lighter for your barbecue. All right. But we're giving to you guys today, we're giving to you a pen and a bookmark. All right. All of you will use the pen somewhere. The bookmark, maybe about 10% of you might use the bookmark, all right? But it's really cool. It's good looking, and it's our gift for you. And every man, you don't have to be a father. You don't have to be married. You're male. You get a pen and bookmark today, okay? Great. While they're passing those out, let me highlight a few prayer requests. Tess Guthrie, usually in the next service. Tess's daughter got married last weekend, and I got a text message from her about 7 this morning that her brother passed away this morning. And so if you'd be remembering the Guthrie family, they would appreciate that very much. Kelly Larry did his memorial service yesterday. He was a dad to two guys that my sons went to high school with. They had been living in Arizona for 10 years due to health concerns, came back, and he died while we were in Mexico. And then Lorraine Killian, I had the privilege of going to high school with her son and her daughter. And Lorraine was 89, and her service was this week. So if you'd remember the Killian family, they would appreciate it. George Mannon is in the hospital. He's in great spirits. They don't know what's wrong. He's just dizzy. He believes it's vertigo, but they're running tests trying to figure it out. Frank Hicks has gone home, and so we are grateful for that. And then Diane Fletcher sent a text this morning. Her granddaughter had to have emergency surgery this week, and her son is not well and has had a series of tests trying to figure out what's going on. Hello, God. Thank you so very much for the call today. Well, that's probably a Father's Day call. Take it. All right? Yeah, I mean, they call so seldom, so take it, you know, when they call. Actually, after my day started well, my oldest son called bright and early this morning. All right, so that was good. He's in North Carolina. I said, wow, you're up early. He said, not really, Dad. It's 3 hours later here than where you are. I said, oh, yeah, how could I forget that? All right, but anyway, that was good. Hey, let's pray. And you were in for a treat during our offertory this morning. Father, we love you. Thank you for life and the privilege of sharing it with you. Thank you for the seasons of life that we may be in, whether we are young and can't imagine that life ever slows down, or, Father, whether life has really slowed down and we wonder if it will ever pick up again. But, Father, you are the God of every season. You are the God who is sufficient for every season. And so we trust you for that. We commit to you the needs that we've already shared this morning and for the needs which are personal and private to those who are sitting here in the pew. May there be a full surrender by each of us of those needs to you, trusting you that you have our best in store. And when we trust you for your best, we can be at rest in all of these circumstances. For the privilege of giving and sharing today, we say thanks. We commit all this to you in the awesome, incredible, marvelous, and matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And amen. I invite you to take your Bibles, if you would please, and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And in a few minutes, we're going to begin reading at verse 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. As most of you know, today we're beginning a series. It's going to be 6 or 7 weeks, and we are looking at 40 days to a healthier you. And over the next 6 weeks, we're going to talk about how each one of us can be healthier than we are today. If we have a desire for this to be true, we must start today so that when becomes then, we expect to experience a difference. When I talk about healthier, I am talking about healthier in every possible way. We will be looking at the subject of faith, which is the nurturing of our soul. We will be talking about food, enjoying God's abundance. We'll be talking about fitness, the strengthening of our bodies. We will talk about focus, which is the renewing of our minds. We will talk about relationships, friends, encouraging one another. We will then wrap it up with follow-through, living a lifestyle that is healthier. You see, being healthier is a choice. And this week, I want us to look at our physical health from an upper story perspective. We want to investigate God's prescription for physical health. I want you to notice I'm very careful in the words that I use. I'm talking about being healthier. I am not talking about being skinnier. Skinnier is not necessary, healthier. That's not the goal. The goal is healthier. I'm not talking about any particular age group. Whatever age group we find ourselves in, there can be a choice that we make to be healthier. We know that the ultimate is outwardly, we are wasting away. But folks, we don't have to make decisions that speed up that process. Okay? We can make decisions that may slow it down a bit. But inwardly, still being renewed day by day. God made us with body, soul, and spirit, and they work together like a hand and a glove. And we want to find out what is God's prescription for our health. Making decisions today that give us the opportunity to be healthier completely tomorrow. Most already who are here, you have a general idea of what's best to do. This is not rocket science. This is not brain surgery. To get healthy, and this can apply physically, spiritually, mentally, and emotionally. To get healthier, we got to eat healthier. We have to eat better. When it comes to the study of God's Word, we have to do that better. When it comes to what we put in this body for physical health, we've got to do better. The right stuff, that's usually not the biggest problem for us, though that's one of them. The next part is the challenge. The right stuff and the right... Look at you two wearing matching shirts today. That is so cool. Check the passerellas out after church, all right? But I'm just trying to soften this next part. It's not only eating right, all right, but eating the proper amounts, all right? And that is sometimes a challenge for all of us. The next part of this is not only eating right, but man, we've got to keep moving, all right? We cannot become sedentary. And I realize, Pops, he's going to be 89 next month. He cannot move the way he used to. My dad was the fastest walking guy around, all right? That's not true anymore, all right? But we all still need to keep moving. We need proper sleep. And this has probably been the biggest one for me over the last few months. Shelly will tell you, man, I have functioned for a lot of years. My average was probably 5.5 hours of sleep a night, all right? 4.5 was okay. 6, you know, was probably too much. And Dad's partly to blame for that. He woke us up at kids at the house saying, don't you know most people die in bed? And so I just developed a habit that, hey, the less time I spent there, the reduction of the risk of dying was to my advantage. But you know what? I'm discovering, wow, if you get consistently that 7 to 8 hours, wow, you have a reservoir down the road then when you need it. And it's remarkable. So proper sleep. Then we need to lower the stress. And when we lower the stress, we get more rest in our life. And all of you know what I've just told you. It's nothing new. What I want to talk about today is focus primarily on our motivation, the why. Why do we not stick with get healthier programs? Why don't we stick with exercise or diet or devotions on a daily basis? How many times have we set a resolution to get in better shape, to do a daily devotion, and in 1 month, it's out the window? Has that ever happened to any of you at all? Oh, okay, fairly captive audience then. We've got to have a reason, the right motivation to stick with it. When we figure out the why in our life, God will take care of the how for us. Often, you and I on this subject tend to be event-driven, all right? We've got a 50th high school reunion to go to. So we're driven to do something. We've got a wedding to get ready for. And so we go to great lengths in order to, we go through months of work for one day events. And then it's out the window. Not the right motivation. So I want us to look at what God says in the Bible about the importance of this thing called our body. Then I want to share a couple of areas of health that maybe you've never thought about and you won't find it in most nutritional books. So, first, let's take a look at what God says about the importance of physical health. It is talked about fairly extensively in the Bible, and the foundational classic passage is the one I ask you to turn to in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and we are going to jump in at verse 12. It starts out, everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible. In other words, I've got the freedom to do just about anything, but I'm not going to be mastered by any of it. In other words, I am not going to become addicted. Though everything may be okay to me, I am not going to become addicted. God is saying there's some things in our life that are not necessarily wrong, they're just not really necessary. Does that make some sense? Can I just kind of keep going? Let me know later if that doesn't make enough sense. But we're free to do what we want, but not everything is beneficial. One of my downfalls food-wise is ice cream. Okay? It's my Grandma McLean's fault. You got to blame somebody, right? But Grandma McLean never saw a bowl of ice cream that she didn't want more. And she always had it in the house. If there is a half gallon, Shelly will tell you this is true, if there is a half gallon of ice cream in the refrigerator, I will wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning because the freezer is screaming at me, help me, help me. And the only way I can help is to go, I literally will take a spoon and I will eat it right out of the box, okay? So we don't keep ice cream around the house just because I can't master it. So we just don't keep it. Food for the stomach, back to the scriptures, food for the stomach and stomach for the food. But God will destroy both. In other words, food or stomach are not going to last forever. That's not the real reason we're here. Back to the scripture, the body is not meant for sexual immorality, but the body is meant for the Lord and the Lord for the body. By His power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and He will raise us also. Guys, physically, this body you're sitting here in with right now, somewhere in the future, it will be raised in perfection from the dead. Is that not awesome? So as a result of that, do you not know that your bodies are the members of Christ Himself? Flee, the Bible says, from sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits are outside his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body. Do you not know? Have you forgotten that now your body is a temple? That is where this phrase comes from. Our body is the temple of who? The Holy Spirit. And I've kind of jumped a couple of verses, but that next one right there is pretty powerful. Shall I then take members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Oh, no, we should not. Our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you've received from God. You are not your own. You are bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. This passage teaches us 6 radical countercultural things about our body. This is the exact opposite. Things I'm going to talk about today are the exact opposite of what culture and our media teaches us about our bodies. Number one. Of the 6 things, and I got several different number ones, okay? So just hang with me. I'll try to keep it clear. Number one, the first thing is God expects us to manage our bodies. I'm not the owner. I'm just the manager. God is the owner, but I am the manager. The Bible word is the word steward. Stewardship is the old English word for management. We're talking about the stewardship of health today. So in other words, I cannot blame other people for how I use, misuse, or abuse my body. I can't blame anybody else. Why? Because I have been given the responsibility of management. My body is a gift from God. This body is on loan from Him. There's no wonder He wanted to loan it out. That's not surprising. But it's on loan from Him. God owns it, and He loans it to me. And though I'm unsure how all of this next part worked, there is enough in the Scripture that challenges us to remember that one day, we, as the children of God, will have a day of accountability with our Heavenly Father. There's going to be one day in which we are going to give an account of that which God has entrusted us with. One day, and again, I don't understand how all this is. I already know my eternal destiny is that heaven is my home, but yet the Bible says there is a day of accountability. There is a judgment day, and it's not just for the non-believers. It's also for the children of God. And God is going to ask, what did you do with what I gave? Maybe it's an opportunity for us to look back from an upper story perspective and see how many things we thought we were doing that were godly when really they were fleshly. They were for our own selfish agenda, even though it may have appeared to be generous to others. And God's also going to reveal to us some things that, hey, when you didn't even know that you were helping somebody, I was at work through you. And God was blessing other people through your life when you weren't even aware of it. We've talked about this many times, but life is a test. Life is a preparation, a readiness for eternity. God has seen what He can trust us with here. And on that day of accountability, He has every right to ask questions like, what did you do with the mind I gave you? Just like, remember, Jesus talked about the 3 guys who had the talents, you know, 10, 5, 1, and all of them had to come back and give an account. What did you do with what I gave you? What did you do with the mind I gave you? What did you do with the opportunities and the abilities and the freedom and the wealth? What did you do with what I gave you? What did you do with the body, the health that I gave you to live in? It seems reasonable to me. God has the right to ask that. I am the caretaker of this body, and God's desire is for us to manage it. Why is that? Why does God desire us to manage this body? Number two, it's because the Bible teaches that my body is God's property. My body, your body, is God's property. Those are fighting words in America, because all of us were taught growing up in the 70s, my body is my own body and I'll do what I want to with it. God says, no, you shouldn't. It's not yours. God says, it's my body. I created it. I have loaned it to you. It's not yours. You didn't create it. Everything that you see was created by God, and the Creator owns it all. We don't own anything. He loans it to us. We've talked about this before, like with our money. We don't own our money. He loans us our money for about 80 years. It's about the average lifespan. So he loans us the money for 80 years. No, he doesn't. I earned that. It's mine. Really? Do you realize your money belonged to somebody else before you came along? And do you realize, after you're through coming along, your money's going to be somebody else's money. It's not yours. It's just been loaned to you. He owns it, and he loans it. My body is God's property. The body, the Bible says, in 1 Corinthians 6:13, is not meant for sexual immorality, but it is the Lord's. Why? Because he is the Lord for the body. In other words, I don't have the right to just share my body with just anybody, and neither do you. This is a radical concept. Behind closed doors in this country, we have said, is nobody's business. Right? That's what we say. Is it right? No, it is wrong. God doesn't acknowledge closed doors. He shows up everywhere, and he's behind those closed doors. You see, we talked about this last year. God created sex, and it's designed to be holy. And he's given us directions how to enjoy the abundance of what he has provided. What Americans do today is we make the common mistake the Greeks made several centuries ago, and it's called dualism. Back in the days of Aristotle and Socrates and Plato, the Greeks believed that we separate the mind and the body. They believed that what matters is your spirit and your mind. And as long as that is right with God, you can do anything with your body that you want to do. They devalued the body. In fact, they taught that the body is evil. So it really doesn't matter if you mess up with your body because it's evil. What matters is only your spirit. And the Bible says that is absolutely false. The Bible says your body is not evil. The Bible says your body is holy because God made it. And everything God makes, he makes for a purpose. God has never made anything without a purpose. So don't compartmentalize that which really matters. It is my spirit. It is my body. It is my mind, it is my emotions, it is my will. They all matter to God. The fact is, God owns our bod. He's the boss of our body. We may not like it, but that doesn't stop it from being the truth. God owns it, and he wants us to manage it well. The third thing is that one day, this body you're sitting here in, do me a favor. Just turn and look at somebody sitting by you, next to you, behind you, in front of you. Just look at them, all right? One of these days, you're going to see if that person you looked at is a believer in Jesus Christ, you are going to see that body in heaven. It will be resurrected one day. Now, it will be perfect. And I know you're saying that I'll never recognize him. No, you will. Not true. You will. You will. But one day this body will be resurrected after I die. God never wastes anything. He doesn't waste hurts if we'll give them to him. He'll take even the hurtful things in our life and turn them around and use them for good. He's not going to waste this body that he has given to us. We may have wasted it, but God will not. God is the original recycler. Okay? He started long before anybody else did. Right now, you and I are living in body version 1.0. Okay? But we're going to get version 2.0 in eternity. You will have a perfected body. Some people think that when we get to heaven, we're just going to be some kind of amorphous spirit, just kind of floating around saying, may the force be with you. Other people think they're going to be angels. Let me clarify something, folks. You will never be an angel. And if you try to say that you're going to be an angel, your loved one's going to be an angel in heaven, you are talking down about them. The angels were not made in the image of God. Only you and I were. And when you and I go to heaven, we don't become part of the angelic host. We become part of the perfected family of God who were created and designed to be in His image. We will be in a perfect state. So you're not going to be an angel. People are people. Many people have the idea that heaven is a white robe, big fluffy wings, playing a harp, sitting on a cloud. I got to tell you what, folks, nothing could be more boring to me than if that's what heaven is like. Why do they always in movies and pictures try to portray heaven as this white out thing? All right? Who do you think created color? God did. Who do you think created taste buds? God did. Who do you think created all the sights and the sounds that give us beautiful music? God, oh, you guys got into it faster than the last crowd. Good. And who do you think created all the beauty that God gave our eyes to see? God did, yeah. If this world, which is as broken as it is as beautiful as it is, what do you think heaven is going to look like? A multicolor extravaganza like we can't believe. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6:14, by His power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and He will raise us also. Do you see how important this body is? God says, I'm not just going to let you die in it and trash it and throw it away. I am going to finish the work. I'm going to resurrect your body. We say, isn't it all going to get decayed in the ground? Yeah. Yeah, it is. I don't care how much formaldehyde and junk they use to try to keep us preserved. The Bible says ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In fact, many of you might choose to be cremated. And this is a great time for me just to get this out in the open. Cremation is okay. Now, if you don't like it, that's okay. But don't try to tell somebody they can't be cremated because the Bible talks against it. The Bible does not talk against it. In fact, if anything, we're speeding up the process. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Okay? I'm not telling you it's the best way. It's not, you know, if you want to go back to the way it was done in the Bible times, we need more caves. Okay? Because everybody was stuffed in caves back then. All right? So, no. But God will put this body back together no matter what it's in with a 2.0 version. And man, if He created the universe, do you think it's going to be a problem for Him to resurrect our bodies? Absolutely not. Now, some say, Tim, what's my resurrected body going to look like? I don't really know for sure. I got some general principles. I do know that after Jesus was resurrected, He walked around Jerusalem for 40 days. And on one occasion, He was observed by over 500 people, and He talked to them. He actually showed up to various ones of the disciples, individually and in small groups and in a larger group. His body actually had some kind of capability to materialize and dematerialize because He could just show up in a room without walking through the door. Kind of cool, isn't it? Kind of like Star Trek. Beam me up, Scotty. All right? Something kind of like that. But we're going to have a different kind of body than we got right now, but it's going to be the resurrected form of this body. You are still going to be you. You are just going to be you 2.0. No blemishes. Perfect in every way. I want you to circle in verse 14, by His power. By His power, God raised the Lord from the dead. This is one of the three reasons why we often don't stick with our Get Healthy programs. The first reason that we don't stick with them is because we use willpower instead of God's power. It is God who raised Jesus from the dead, not willpower. Willpower works for about 3 weeks. Then we get tired and we go off the program. Because willpower is not enough to change. Willpower is fantastic for the short run. But the entire time we're doing something by willpower that we're forcing ourselves to do, that our natural brain does not want to do, then pretty soon we're going to get tired and we're going to let go of the steering wheel and the autopilot of the boat is just going to flip us around and take us back in the other direction. That's why resolutions by themselves don't last. We need more than willpower. We need God's power because willpower is exhausting. Whatever our weakness is, we're going to probably struggle with that weakness for the rest of our life. So we're going to need more than simply our own energy. We've got to plug in to God's power. That's the first reason we don't stick with it. Second reason is we don't stick with it because we have the wrong motivation. When the goal to get healthier is all about me, That's not enough to keep most people going. We need something bigger than ourselves to draw us out of ourselves so that we can be greater than ourselves to get us out of bed in the morning. I can't tell you how many get healthier times, whether it's diet or exercise program I've started, simply because I wanted to look better, which is obvious. I want to feel better, and I want to live longer. Now, there's nothing wrong with any one of those three reasons or all three of those. In fact, they're legitimate. But what we're talking about today is far deeper than those three issues. There's far more spiritual significance to being healthier than simply looking good and feeling better. There are other reasons. We're looking at those six reasons right now, and appearance is not enough. Many have discovered that once we get to the goal that we wanted to be at, we sort of stop caring, we stop trying, we stop using willpower, and we default right back to the old habits and the old ways. And soon we're yo-yoing back and forth. Has anybody lost the same 20 pounds three times or more? Okay, yeah. So, wrong motivation when I'm using willpower instead of God's power. The third reason why we often don't stick is we try to change by ourselves. We try to do it all on our own. It's probably not going to happen. We are made for community. We were created for fellowship. We need group support. We need a partner or a coach. We've got to have accountability. That's why we encourage nearly 500 people in this church to be engaged in small groups every single week. Why? Because we know we cannot get there on our own. You say, one of these days I'm going to change. Well, folks, if we could, we would have done it already. But we can't, so we don't. We need each other. We're better together. When I try to change on my own, it doesn't work. When Shelly and I kind of started doing some of this a couple of months ago, one of the reasons was to find out what causes some of the issues with her stomach. And it was clear if she had to do that all by herself, we were going to be cooking differently. So why not do this together? And she would hold me. I walked by the desk in the office, and it's my habit, all right, to keep my breath sparkling. There's peppermints. If you ever go to Teresa's desk, you know, there's a bowl of peppermints. Those are because of my favorite candy. And so when we started the 10-day cleanse a couple of months ago, I went by and just out of habit, I grabbed for the peppermint. And Shelly happened to be there right at that moment. And she said, "You're going to eat that?" Oh. It wasn't an attitude of rebellion. It was an attitude of habit. I hadn't even thought, oh, you're right. Not with what we're doing right now. We did it together. Some of you guys run. Eric. Yeah, Eric started running half marathons. I'm not even going to investigate the why question, all right? Because that one probably doesn't make sense. But we got several in our church who do this. They run. Do you run by yourself most of the time, or do you often run with others? Yeah, we train. Why? Because you're accountable. You motivate. If you do it by yourself, you'll take shortcuts. You just won't even go at all. But when others are holding you accountable. So the same thing is true in this process. We together can do this. God says, I created your body. I expect you to manage it. One day I'm going to resurrect it. All right, now to the number four out of 1 Corinthians 6. The Bible teaches that my body is connected to the body of Christ. You probably never heard this before, but the Bible says, my body is connected to Christ. Verse 15, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Now, if we were to stop right there and not read the next verse, we might think, no. What Paul's talking about is the fact that I'm a Christian, the Holy Spirit living within my human spirit. My spirit's connected to the Holy Spirit, and so the knee bone's connected to, yeah. So we're all together in this. No. He's talking about our physical body. This is not a spiritualization of the Christian life. Because notice what he says next. Do you not know that our members are members of Christ himself? And then what does he say next? Flee sexual immorality. Isn't that the physical body? Flee sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits outside his body. That's why it's kind of in a special class. We're not just sinning against God, but we're sinning also against ourselves. The fifth reason is the Holy Spirit lives in this body. God puts his spirit inside your human spirit, which resides inside this body. Verse 19, do you not know that your body is the what? Temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God. That means God takes up residence inside of you. He puts his spirit right here. So we are the walking temple of God today. We study history and God. We discover God has always had a dwelling place on earth. First, he dwelt in the tabernacle designed according to specifications given to Moses. The tabernacle was the dwelling place of God in the midst of the nation of Israel. Then later, God gave to David the specifications for the temple in Jerusalem, and his son Solomon built it. And God dwelt in the Holy of Holies in the city of Jerusalem inside that temple. And today he says, I now dwell in you. In your life is where I reside. If you were out walking down the street, and you saw a gang vandalizing New Hope Church or another house of worship or a synagogue or a temple, and people were writing graffiti on it, what would you do? At minimum, you would call the police and say, hey, at maximum, you might run over there and try to stop them. You wouldn't just ignore it. At least I hope you wouldn't. But folks, I suggest to you that many of us, without thinking, vandalize a temple all of the time. By the way in which we care for our body, by what we put in it, by our sleep schedule, by not taking care of it, we're vandalizing the temple of God. Number six, Jesus bought our bodies on the cross. That's one thing that he came to do. In verse 20, 1 Corinthians 6, you are not your own. You are bought with a price. Next sentence, honor God with your body. With your body. Jesus bought this piece of real estate. And I'm telling you, he overpaid for it. He paid more than it's worth. Have you ever thought about how much you're worth? If you want to know, look at the cross. With arms outstretched and nail-pierced hands, Jesus said, this is how much I love you. I love all of you, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. I don't care if you're a Buddhist or a Baptist or Jewish or Mormon or atheist. He said, how much I love you? I love you this much, and it hurts to love you this much. I love you so much, I'd rather die than live without you. I came all the way from heaven to earth to do this for you because of what Christ was willing to pay for us. The appraised value of our real estate jumped unbelievably higher. Our body is now priceless. When you want to sell your home and somebody wants to buy it, what do you have to get? An appraisal. And that appraisal is based on what? The value of other homes in your neighborhood that have sold within a certain period of time. Do you realize before the cross, every single one of us dwelt on Poverty Row? Do you realize after the cross, all of us live on Van Ness Extension? That's what we're worth in God's economy. If you owned a $1 million racehorse, would you feed that racehorse junk food all the time? You'd be crazy, but we put that stuff on our own body and we are priceless. I urge you, brothers, Book of Romans, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer what? Your bodies as living sacrifices. It doesn't say offer your soul. It says offer your body, this physical body. You cannot serve God. Your spirit and soul cannot serve God except through our bodies. People often say to pastors, Pastor, I can't be there Sunday physically, but I'm going to be there in spirit. A lot of people told me that today. You know what that means? Nothing. Absolutely, because you can't be somewhere you aren't. You can only be where you are physically in your body. Your spirit doesn't leave you. It says, offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Did you know that taking care of your health is an act of worship? That's a different motivation than feeling better and looking better, isn't it? Let me summarize this portion. I want to get my body in better health. As a pastor who loves you, I want you to get your bodies in better health. Not just so you look good and take up less space on the pew. Not just so you can feel good and not just so you can live longer. Though I would be glad for all of that. Those are legitimate motives. But because of these six things, God created you. Jesus died for your body. God's Spirit lives in our body. I'm connected to Christ's body. One day I'm going to be resurrected in this body, and I'm expected to take care of my body, and one day I will give an account. Those are spiritual reasons. Based on these six facts, and you see how caring for your body is more than I'd like to look better? It really is a spiritual discipline. The healthier we are, the more God can bless us and the more God can use us. We have heard people say, when in doubt, consult an owner's manual. This is the owner's manual. Nobody knows more about this body than God does. If we'll do what He says, we're going to be healthier. There are all kinds of health promises and health principles and health programs in the Word of God. Well, I'm doing good. I got 12 minutes. Psalm 119, write this one down. Psalm 119, 73 says, "You made my body, Lord. Now give me sense to heed your laws." What laws is he going to be talking about? He's going to be talking about laws that pertain to this physical body. He set it up in the context. You made my body. Now give me sense to heed your laws. A lot of people always are praying for a miracle. God, help me feel better. Help me recover from whatever this is I'm going through. And if he were to do that, you would go back and do the same thing next week that put you in the situation you're in today. Why would he do it? We ask God to get us out of the financial disaster we're in, but yet we won't go through the steps necessary, like putting a budget together so that it doesn't happen again. Why would he be obligated? The Word says, "You made my body, give me sense to heed it." Deuteronomy 32, you find this passage. "These instructions are not mere words. They are your life. By obeying them, you will enjoy a long life in the land." If I stood up here today and said, "Hey, guys, I have discovered a new pill that will guarantee long life. This pill is guaranteed to extend your life." You'd pay big bucks for that, right? And then if I said, "Oh, whoa, wait a minute, folks, wait, before you make a final decision, if I threw in a set of Jinsu knives, oh, wait, how about three easy payments, $19.95, we'll automatically put it on your credit card." Operator standing by right now. How many of you would pay big bucks for a pill that would extend your life? I got to be honest, I was a little nervous about using the word extend in this conversation in light of TV commercials, but you get the point. Here's the deal, folks. You don't have to pay me a thing. This is free. It's all right here in this book. There is a promise after promise after promise. Do a Bible study of all the verses, and there are many that say, if you do this, I will extend your life. If you do this, your life will be long. If you do this, it's all throughout the Scripture. By the way, 98,000 Americans are now over 100 years of age. So the likelihood is we're going to probably live longer than our parents. The question is, what kind of quality of life are we going to have? Are we going to actually live our life like Moses did, where it says he was as sharp and in full health the day he died as he was when he was 40 years old? That's pretty incredible, folks. But do you understand the point? He still died. See, don't miss the point. Getting healthy is not going to stop us from dying. The Bible says it's appointed unto us once to die. And after that, judgment, accountability time. So being healthy is not going to stop us from dying. God has a plan and a time for us. But when my time comes, I want to be as healthy as possible, both physically and spiritually. By the way, the healthiest place to live, if you didn't know this, the longest longevity in life in America, where do you think it might be? Fresno? Sorry. No. Clovis? No. No. Hawaii. You live the longest in Hawaii. You figure that, hang loose, no stress, baby. You know where the second highest longevity is? Hawaii did not surprise me. Number two surprises me. Minnesota. All right. Wow. Do you want to know where the worst place is? No. Far worse than that. The 51st place, all 50 states in the District of Columbia. It is the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., all right? Don't move there. As I said, you already know about nutrition, exercise, sleep, rest. This is not rocket science. Let me wrap this up and point out a few factors that maybe will be helpful out of the Scriptures. Proverbs 3 gives us a few verses. Verses 1 through 10 says this, "Keep my commands in your heart, says God, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you prosperity." And then he gives us some commands. "Trust in the Lord with all of your heart," and do what? "Lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways acknowledge him." What's he saying? He's saying, trust in me instead of worry. Don't get stressed out. You got a doctor's appointment and they're running a test? Oh my goodness, I might have cancer and die. Yes, you might. Yes, you very well might. That's a fact. You might lose your nose. You very well may. But what does the worry in the waiting room do? Nothing. Does it trust God? No. And it doesn't mean we put our head in the sky and say, oh, everything's going to be just fine. No, in this life, it may not be. It may not be. But distress over it, is that God's best for you? See, Paul said, I've learned to be content in whatever situation I find myself. The writer of this wise passage says, trust in the Lord. Not trust in your own resources, not trust in the doctor's advice, though we want to follow it most of the time. But he said, that's not where our trust is. Our trust is going to be in Him. Whether I live, Paul said, or whether I die. Either or. One is good, the other's better. And yet we act like if God is wrong on that. We act so often as if to live is better and to die is worse. And the Bible says, no, to live is Christ. To die is gain. It is better. So he says, trust. Don't try to figure it all out. He'll make our path straight. That's integrity, living a straight life. Do not be wise in your own eyes. That's humility. Fear the Lord and shun evil. This will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. Why did God say nourishment to your bones? What's produced inside our bone? The marrow. So very, very important. And then it says, honor the Lord with the first part of your wealth. That's generosity. The first fruits of all your crops and your barns will be filled. Notice this passage mentions tranquility, trust in God, integrity, straight paths, humility. Don't be wise in your own eyes. Generosity, give the first part away. If you live a life of tranquility, integrity, humility, and generosity, you are going to be in better health. There's this direct connection between spiritual health and physical health. So let me wrap this up. I could give you 100 of these out of the Word of God, but let me just highlight these four in summation. Number one, trust God. Trusting God is good for your health. When you trust, you don't worry. You are either going to worship or worry in the circumstances of your life. You are either going to pray, bless you, or you're going to panic. If you pray, you won't panic. And if you panic, you probably won't pray. If you worship, you'd have a whole lot less to worry about. Trust God, the Bible says in Psalm 116:7, I said to myself, relax, because the Lord takes care of you. Proverbs 14:30, a heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. Wow, that's rather direct, isn't it? Friends, it's not just what you eat that matters. It's what eats at you that really matters. You can have the best microbiotic plan. You can eat fresh and healthy, organic, in proper portions, but if you're resentful against your dad, if you're envious against your friend, if you're bitter against your mom, or you're feeling guilty about something you did last week or last year, if that's eating you, if you say, she's a pain in my, that's why I have a pain in my. You see, resentment and bitterness are like poison. It's like a fire. It burns us out from the inside. It's not just what we eat. It's what eats at us. There is an issue here that says, trust God. And then getting rid of the stuff, that leads us to number two. Confess our sins. This requires humility. We will never admit we're wrong until we're humbled. And for some of us, we're a little stubborn, and it requires humiliation to learn humility. It's not God's purpose. He would love for us just to acknowledge that we need Him. But sometimes it requires severe humbling. We could talk to any psychologist who could confirm this one. You shouldn't repress it. You shouldn't suppress it. You need to express it to God. We confess it. When I swallow my anger, my stomach keeps score. If we don't talk it out to God, we're going to take it out on our body. So the Bible says this, David in Psalm 32, when I refused to confess my sin, I was weak and I was miserable. It's possible to feel guilty and happy at the same time. David goes on to say, I groaned all day long. My strength evaporated. That's why you're weak all the time. You're carrying garbage bags of guilt around. David said, finally, I confessed all of my sins to you, and I stopped trying to hide them, and you forgave me, and now all of my guilt is gone. We used to sing a song, G-O-N-E, now my sins are gone. One of the healthiest things you can do is to receive the forgiveness of God in your life. Throw away the garbage sack, garbage and all. Trusting God is good for our health. Confessing my sin is good for our health. Number three, giving generously is good for our health. It's good for our heart. Every time I give, our heart gets bigger. Every time I give, I break the grip of materialism in my life. People often say, I'm not materialistic. Here's a self-study. Check your checkbook. Examine how you spend your money and your time, and that will tell you where your priority is. There are more promises in the Bible about giving and generosity than any other subject, because God says, I want you to learn to be like me. God is a giving God. He's generous, and everything we have is a gift from Him. And we wouldn't take our next breath if God didn't give it to us. Everything we have, the next beat of our heart, it is a gift from God. Everything we have, God says, like Father, like Son, I want my kids to be like me. I want you to learn to be generous. And every time we give generously, instead of keeping and hoarding, we are healthier. It's not a mistake that the word miser and miserable come from the same word. Proverbs 11:25 says, a generous person will prosper. He who refreshes others will himself be refreshed. And finally, number four, and I wish I had a lot more time to go into this, but I don't. And too often the church doesn't take much time for this. But the scripture says, having fun is good for your health. Having fun is good for your health. The Bible says that life is meant to be enjoyed, not just endured. The Bible teaches us that God created everything for our enjoyment. In Proverbs 17:22, a cheerful heart. That's a healthy attitude, a happy, fun-loving, laughter, humorous, cheerful heart. It is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. It sucks the marrow out of it. Somebody said, he who laughs lasts. And I like that. I've learned from personal experience, if I learn to laugh at myself, I will never run out of material. It just keeps coming. We need to put some fun in our life, put play in every day. People say the family that prays together stays together. True, but also the family that plays together stays together. We need to have some fun in life. Somebody said it's better to have loafed and lost than never to have loafed at all. I like that. I really will wrap up. The book of Daniel. The Persian Empire has taken over the world at this point, and the guy who was king was a guy named Nebuchadnezzar. He took over the nation of Israel, and he captured several people out of Jerusalem. He brought a guy by the name of Daniel and three other guys that we know as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these guys were going to serve the king's table. They got to eat all the rich foods, drink all the fine wines. And part of it was a job and a responsibility. Part of it was also a little bit of a perk that they got with the job that they were doing. Daniel did not want to lose contact with his God or his identity with his God. He didn't want his relationship with the God of Israel to get swallowed up in the false teachings and the false gods of Nebuchadnezzar. And so Daniel said, hey, instead of us eating everything that you guys eat, we would just like to eat fresh fruits and vegetables. And the guy said, no, you can't do that. We want to keep you healthy and strong so you can serve the king. And Daniel said, why don't you see what our God can do in 10 days with our lives if we don't follow your leadership. And in 10 days, those four Jewish young men were far healthier than all of the other king's men. And those four guys were said, keep doing what you're doing. Keep doing what you're doing. In John 5, Jesus is walking down the street and he sees a guy sitting on the side of the road who's been paraplegic for 38 years. Jesus walks up to him and he asks one of the most important questions. And it's a question I want to leave you with today. Jesus walked up to the man on the side of the road, sick for 38 years, and Jesus point blank asked him, do you want to get well? Do you want to get healthier in all of your life? It's a profound question. I think all of us would say, well, of course the guy wants to get healthier. Do you? Where do you want to be a year from now? Where do you want to be a month from now? Do you want a sharper mind, a brighter smile, more energy, stronger body? Do you really want to be healthier? When you leave today and you go out here, there's a table, and I said there's a couple of books. We're going to talk more about those books next week, so it's okay if you don't want to run out there. But some of you are saying, Tim, I battle all kinds of things. I understand that, but wherever we are, we can make choices today that can impact our health for tomorrow. Is it going to stop us from dying? Absolutely not. But it can make the difference in the way in which we live between now and the day that God calls us home. Do you want to be better? Let's pray. Father, thank you for your truth. Thank you, Father, for the fact that you have created our bodies. You sent your son, the Lord Jesus, and the Lord Jesus was willing to come, and with his body, he was willing to pay for our bodies. And then, Father, after his resurrection, you sent to us your Holy Spirit to come live and to bring life to our human spirit. And where does the spiritual life function? It functions inside this body. Father, help us never to forget that our bodies belong to you, not us. That our body is connected to the body of Christ. So everything we do with this body, whether it's how we feed it, whether it's how we rest it, whether it's the sexual acts that we are engaged in, that as a believer, you are there with us. One day, Father, we have this incredible promise that we are going to get version 2.0, and it will be perfect. Father, forgive us now while we still have 1.0 for the times that we've misused or abused our body. I pray that many of us over these next few weeks will commit to join in a journey of a healthier life. Your plan for your glory, for our best. We commit this to you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. Have a great week. See you next Sunday. Next Sunday, Tim Kepler will be joining us for worship.